So thanks very much for the invitation to speak here. I should say this is all joint with Matt Emerton, and the second half of it is also joint with Ana Caraiani, with Matt again, and with Dave Savitt. So when I was invited to talk at this conference, I was reminded by at least one of the organizers that when I last spoke under the, I think it was under the funding of the same grant, I gave too much motivation and didn't get as far as the details of the theorems. So there are several ways to avoid that. One would be to do what Frank and Mark did and start with some theorem and then fill in the details. But instead, I'm going to have no motivation and no theorem at the beginning. And I'm going to give you all the definitions, but hopefully I've left enough time to get to the theorems. So we'll see if this works. Well, maybe we can just make this 10 minutes then. Yeah. Okay, well, on those grounds, so the first half is this paper with Matt Emerton, which is on the archive and on my webpage. So maybe I can just say you should all just read that. And there is some motivation in the introduction, so you could read that. But okay, let's start with some definitions. So P is going to be a prime number. I'm always going to assume that P is odd. I think this is actually only needed in probably the final theorem I'll state, but I'll doubtless forget if I don't state it now. It can probably be removed even there, but it would require quite a bit of work. But I think there's no essential obstruction. So then I want to consider two fields, K primed and K. And this is all, these are finite extensions. This is a finite extension of QP. And this extension here is tamely ramified. And in fact, for simplicity, I'll even assume that that the actual degree of this is not divisible by P. Although that's not really going to be a real issue, but it makes things a little simpler. I want to fix a uniformizer of K primed. So K primed in K, a uniformizer with the property that if I set pi, thank you, K primed, such that pi primed to the ramification degree of K primed over K is actually in K and is then a uniformizer. So if you like, I could be, and maybe I should call this pi. Okay, so I can do that. I will at least use some of the notation of OK primed OK for the rings of integers. The residue fields will be K primed and K. The absolute ramification and inertial degrees will be E and F. So hopefully, I probably won't use all of those, but that's the notation I'll have in mind. Let's let E of U be the characteristic polynomial of pi primed. So it's the Eisenstein polynomial for pi primed. So it's the characteristic polynomial of this over, I guess, W k primed 1 on p. And I'm going to let phi denote the arithmetic Frobenius on the bit vectors of K primed. And then I want to use a ring that I think was probably first introduced in periodic Hodge theory by Christoph Breuer and then used by Mark Kissin, which is some kind of, what is this, a Gothic S? I don't know. This is supposed to be your... It's supposed to be a Gothic S. Okay. So that's what it... I mean, there's not going to be any other symbol that remotely looks like that I write, so... Whenever you see that, that's what this means. And this is just a power series ring in one variable over the bit vectors of K primed. And this has an action of this Frobenius. So it's this Frobenius on the bit vectors, and it sends... U to U to the P. And there's also an action of the, well, maybe I want to say like this, an action of the Galois group of K primed over K. And what does this do? This So this action is given by if we how do I want to write it? I want to write g of the sum of ai u to the I is the sum of ai g of pi primed on pi primed to the I u to the I. I think that's hopefully the correct formula. Okay, so this thing here is just some root of unity in k primed, and so it lives in wk primed, I guess, written in the units in there. Sorry? Sorry, thank you. Yes. Sorry. I knew there was something that was missing, but I couldn't see what. Okay, and then if A is any ZP algebra, I'll write S sub A, not for this tensored up to A, but this is WK primed tensor ZP A double brackets U with the sort of obvious A linear extensions of the phi and the Galois action. So in some circumstances, this will be the sort of U-adic completion of this tensored up with A, but not always. Sorry. I think my assumption that this here is in K. If there are enough roots, yeah.
But anyway, you're assuming that.
So I think it's fine. Okay, so good. That's the first order definition. So I can now actually define something, something more. I probably want to. This is where I should have worked out which board was which, but hopefully this will be the great. Okay, so definition. A Kissin module also call them Broy-Kissin modules, but at least in the paper these are going to appear and there's going to be Broy modules as well, so we just opted for Kissin modules of height less than or equal to h, so h is some non-negative integer with a coefficients. And descent data from k prime to k is a triple. So there's some Gothic M, something called V sub M, and some things called G hat running over the elements of this Galois group, such that the following things hold. Well, firstly, M is a finitely generated module over SA. Finitely generated, in fact, U torsion free. SA module. This phi sub M is a map from phi upper star m to m. So what is this phi upper star m? This is just the sort of tensor product of m with this SA over itself via the Frobenius, which is SA linear. And it has this PM has a couple of properties. Firstly, I want that the co-kernel of this morphism is killed by this Eisenstein polynomial to the power h. And I also want, and this will frequently be implied by this one, but again, maybe not always, that when I invert u, I get an isomorphism. So frequently, I'm going to, for example, work it with rings which are sort of p-torsion, and then this will be a consequence, but not always. So that's the first part. So if I didn't say with descent data, this would be a kissing module of height at most h with a coefficients. And the descent data is these guys, g hat, are maps from m to m. They're additive bijections such that some very obvious, but some natural properties hold. So they're kind of commute with the phi, and they are sort of semi-linear for the action of g on the coefficients and so on. Just kind of the axioms you would imagine. I think I want that when I invert u, that it's an isomorphism, yes. No, I mean, in practice, I'm going to be working over p-torsion rings, and this won't be an issue. But that is what I'm going to want. Okay, so then we say furthermore that, so the ones I'm really going to care about are a little more well-behaved, but these are the ones going to be... yes. Well, I would say that there are some conditions I could write down. No. There's just like sort of that G, if I do G and H, that's the same as doing G, H. Yeah, I mean, so that's the co-cycle condition, but it's really trivial in this case.
Do you mean it's a
isomorphism when you invert U? No, I think I just mean when I invert U. When I tensor with SA1 on U. I mean, I don't want to complete after inverting U, that would be... Okay, so what I'm going to say, this is locally free of rank D. This is a slightly odd definition, as you'll see, if it is a finitely generated... Well, I've already said it's finitely generated, but if it's a projective module over this coefficient ring, and furthermore, it is Sarisky locally on spec A, free of rank D. So what does this condition mean? This means that I've got a kind of Sarisky cover by some spec Bs, so that when I tensor up to the coefficient ring for B, that this is a free SB module of rank D. So probably if you're better at commutative algebra than we are, you can see some redundancies in this. But for completely general rings A, it's not clear to us that kind of either of these conditions imply the other, this local freeness or the projectivity. Yeah, commutative, I mean. But they might not be Noetherian, for example, and they might not be finite type or anything. No, just commutative. Yeah. I mean, I should say that this is kind of to make these definitions in some sense easier. You could get away with defining things on a much smaller category of modules and then extending. We could sort of define it on, I mean, ultimately, we're going to start off with maybe FP and then look at FP algebras, and we could get away with defining it on finitely presented FP algebras and then taking some completion and so on. But this is the kind of easiest thing to write down in some sense. Okay, so those are kissing modules. I need another kind of semilinear algebra gadget, which is an Atal phi module with A coefficients. And descent data. From k prime to k is, well, it's a bit simpler, it's the same kind of thing, but with u inverted, so it's another triple. Now I'm just going to use Roman letter. Where, so now M is a finitely generated S1 on U module. Now, this phi is just an isomorphism. And the, I should say it's a, of course, it's an isomorphism of modules over this. And then there's a sort of G hat, these descent data as before. So, which again satisfy some natural conditions. And again, we have a notion of a locally free thing. Well, I should say, so M, a Kissin module of some height, with A coefficients and descent data gives us an Atal phi module just by tensoring up with the coefficients with U inverted. OK, so I want to say M is locally free of rank D if it is, something similar to the above, a finitely generated projective SA 1 on U module. And it is FPQC locally on spec A. Free of rank D. And again, this is in the same kind of sort of completed tensor product type sense of I tensor up with these now with U inverted. And so again, I don't know what the exact relationship is between this condition and this condition. I should say that it turns out if you work, if A is an algebra over z mod p to the n for some n, then we know that you can replace FPQC here with Atal, but it's even the argument for that is some complicated thing. Quite possibly, someone, again, a bit better at commutative algebra could just sort of make this definition a lot simpler, but that's what we work with. Okay, so now let's introduce the kind of stacks we want to work with, or some of them at least. So let's fix D. And in practice, for the theorems later, it's going to be 2. But for now, the first bunch of theorems, we don't need it to be 2. This is a definition. This is just a definition of what we say to be locally free of rank D. Yes, but those were before I inverted U. So in fact, in this definition, this definition is equivalent to it. To if I could replace Zariski with FPQC, and it would be equivalent. Yeah, here I suspect that's probably not true, but at least I don't know. Yeah, sorry, good point. OK, but yes, certainly it's still true that if I take a Kissin module that's free of rank D with this locally free of rank D with this definition, then I can get an Atal phi module, which is locally free of rank D. OK, so now let's also fix or take two integers a and h at least one, or actually h could be at least zero, but that wouldn't be so interesting. And then we define, where do I want to put my subscripts? C a less than or equal to h, and R a are going to be the tile stacks and groupoids over spec mod C mod P to the A Z. So these are essentially things that were defined by Pappas and Rapoport, although their version didn't have descent data, but the definition's the same, except we're putting descent data in. So what are these? You set C A less than or equal to H to be the Kissin modules with A coefficients and descent data from K prime to K, which are locally free of rank D, and the height is the most H. And similarly, R is the same thing, but with the Atal phi modules. And it's not obvious, at least to me, but these are Atal stacks. In fact, they're even FPQC stacks by a theorem of Jungfeld's, which, yeah, I'm not going to go into. But the theorem I want here, theorem of Pappas and Rapoport, so again, this theorem is proved in their paper in the case without descent data, but this tame descent data is kind of almost trivial to add to their theorem, so it's definitely theirs, but they sort of prove the case k prime equals k. So they prove, among other things, the following properties of these. So this stack of Kissin modules of bounded height is an algebraic stack of finite type. So this is some very reasonable thing. So there's a... No, it's an Artin stack. Yeah. So there's a natural map, I should have said, from this guy to this guy, which is just this inverting U map. And so this map, this morphism, is representable by algebraic spaces. Algebraic spaces. It's proper, and it's a finite presentation. And the diagonal of R, so the diagonal of C is certainly representable because it's an algebraic stack, and the diagonal, so I should give us a name, I guess, of R is also representable by algebraic spaces. And it's a finite presentation. No, because it's not an algebraic stack. So yeah, I'll come to that in a minute. So that's kind of the problem, or a problem. Okay, so yeah, I mean, the problem with R is basically that it's, or one of the problems with R is it's kind of infinite dimensional, so it isn't algebraic. So theorem, this is the main theorem, again in the case that K prime equals K, but it goes over easily. So theorem in this first paper with Emerton is that RA is an indalgebraic stack. I'll explain what I mean by that in just a second. So it's in the kind of nicest sense of this. So we can write it as a limit, a direct limit of things I call RA less than or equal to H. And the transition morphisms are just closed immersions, and these guys are finite type algebraic spaces. So algebraic stacks, they're not algebraic spaces. Finite type algebraic stacks. Okay, so this, as the notation suggests, this thing here is the scheme theoretic image in the appropriate sense of this morphism whose source is algebraic. OK, so if you know that, if you happen to know for some other reason that this was in the algebraic, then this would be a relatively easy thing to define. But in fact, as far as we know, there's no kind of general notion in the literature for scheme theoretic images of morphisms from algebraic stacks to non-algebraic stacks. So we have to make up a slightly, well, it's a definition that's somewhat general, but quite well adapted to the precise situation we're in of such a thing. And we initially just define these guys as stacks, or even maybe just as categories 5 but in groupoids. And then we prove that they are actually algebraic stacks by using Artin's representability theorem. And the kind of hard work is to do with versality. So in fact, I'll explain in a minute why just versality itself is not so hard, the existence of sort of deformation rings at formal completions. But proving the effectiveness and openness of the versality is a lot of work, at least the way we do it. So I don't want to go into the proof of this, but as I say, that's the paper that's on the archive now. So what I should do next is talk about the connection to Galois representations. So maybe I'll do that over here. At least briefly. So as you probably know, the motivation for thinking about Kissin modules and Ital phi modules is that they have a connection with Galois representations. And the idea is going to be that we can think of these stacks here as being sort of stacks of Galois representations. But let me give you some brief indication of why we can do that. So you need to fix, I won't ever kind of refer to this choice, but it's you need to fix such a choice of p to the nth roots of pi. So these are now in an algebraic closure of QP. And having done so, I let K infinity be the union of the fields I get by adjoining this. So this is some infinite, totally ramified non-Galois extension of K. And I'll let GK infinity be the sort of absolute, the absolute Galois group of this. And then the theorem of Fontaine, which this is a rather special case, let me just sort of state something kind of simple. But if I take finite, literally a finite coefficient ring, then there's a natural correspondence between the continuous GK infinity representations on finite A modules and, I mean, I guess it's a finite, I want to do a finite ZP algebra as always, and these are Ital phi modules. With A coefficients and descent data. So this comes just from a similar correspondence for sort of GK primed infinity in the descent data. Works well on both sides. Okay, so we'll say that a Galois representation of this kind, a GK infinity representation, has height at most H if it corresponds under this to an M, which I can write in the form M1 on U, where M has height at most H, okay? So this Gothic M need not be unique in general if there's lots of ramification. And then our results of Broy and Kissin relate this, in the case H equals 1, relate this to finite flat group schemes in a way that I would explain in just a second. Oh, so perhaps I should say that already, using this correspondence, you can see that versal rings for this this stack R are given by deformation or frame deformation rings for GK infinity representations. And the tangent spaces to those deformation rings are infinite dimensional, so you can kind of see without so much work that this R is not going to be an algebraic stack. It turns out it satisfies, it turns out, although it's not obvious, but it turns out to be limit preserving, so somehow if it was an algebraic stack, it would be something that satisfied Artin's axioms, and in particular it would have Noetherian versal rings, but it's actually got these infinite dimensional ones. So it really is some infinite dimensional gadget. Okay. Anyway, back to the point, which was to talk about height at most one representations. So these correspond to finite flat group schemes, or in this case, finite flat group schemes with descent data. So maybe here's some special case of a theorem of Kissin, which was conjectured by Broy. Let's just do the case of Z mod PZ coefficients, then free Kissin modules with Z mod PZ coefficients and descent data. These correspond to finite flat group schemes height at most one finite flat group schemes over OK primed, which are killed by P, so P torsion, and to sort of together with descent data down to K. Okay, sorry. And I have got PS. Yes, I should say, I was immediately going to say, and I actually want the version of this with mod P to the A coefficients, where I have to say that all of the P to the A torsions are, or P to the B torsions are finite flat as well, but yes, sorry. And I should say that, yes, there's a natural compatibility between these things with inverting U and restricting to GK infinity and so on. Also, I'm going to need this later, that the Dieudonné module of these things is sort of given by just modding out by U. So there's a natural, an easy recipe for the Dieudonné module of the finite flat group scheme, together with descent data, just by looking at the action of phi on this and using the height 1 condition. Okay, so at least morally, we can think of RA as being a moduli of GK infinity representations. And RA at most one as being some moduli of GK representations. Which are finite flat over, once you've restricted to GK primed. And of course, this is a description that really only makes sense on the finite type points, but it's a useful description. It's what we want to use. So these aren't quite, I want to tell you basically some theorems about this algebraic stack, but it's actually not quite the thing I want to consider. So now I'm going to really fix D is definitely 2. And I want to I want to fix an extension, a finite extension, which is sufficiently large, which will be my field of coefficients. And it's going to have a ring of integers, OE and var pi e a uniformizer. And maybe, I don't know if I'll need it, but let's just say that F is the residue field. And what we want to add to everything in sight is some kind of additional condition. So these are all defined mod p to the a at the moment. You can imagine, I'm not literally going to do this, but you can imagine taking a limit over these and getting some p-adic stacks. And then the idea would be that those would now be the ones, I mean, the representations here would be sort of generic fibers of p-divisible groups. So if you like, they'd be crystalline representations, all of whose Hodge tape weights are 0 or 1. And for kind of automorphic purposes, what we really want are the things that would correspond to weight 2 modular forms, for example. So we want to sort of fix the Hodge tape weights to be exactly a 0 and a 1. So I don't want Artin representations coming in. So the way you do this is we add, it's a slight variant on a Kotwitz condition, which I don't want to give the exact definition of. But it's basically saying that all labeled Hodge tape weights when you go to the p-adic limit are literally equal to 0 and 1 and not two zeros or two ones. Okay, so I'm going to have some notation, and I'm also going to sort of take the product of all my stacks up to OE, and then the notation for what I'm going to end up with, I'm going to change the notation slightly. I apologize for that, but sort of approximate the paper in progress so I don't get too confused. Let's maybe just write that slightly lower so I'm not merging all my notations. So C E less than or equal to 1 A maps to Z less than or equal to 1 A. And that goes to R A. And so these AE means that I work with O mod pi to the A coefficients. And this is the Kissin modules of height at most 1, those coefficients, and this Kotwitz condition. This is the scheme theoretic image. And these are kind of all of the Atal three modules with these coefficients and descent data. Okay, so this morphism, this is again some infinite dimensional thing, but these are algebraic stacks of finite type. So this is a proper morphism of algebraic stacks of finite type. Okay, so these are the guys I want to tell you something about. Okay, so I am going to manage to state the theorem, so that's good. Okay, so let's send this board back up. So the first thing that turns out not to be too hard to do is to say what the closed points of this stack in the middle are. And hopefully that will show you why I'm interested in it in the first place. So by kind of these theorems about p-adic Hodge theory I was stating, this shouldn't be so surprising. So the closed points of what am I calling this thing? I'm going to get my having been careful about writing, I'm going to get muddled, but this are just corresponding to mod p Gower representations. So these correspond to representations rho bar and gk to gl2, maybe f primed now, some finite extension of f. They have some property. No. I mean, if I've got, if it's z mod p to the a roughly, then the closed points are the same. I mean, they're just some nilpotent thickening. So if you like, you can think a equals 1, but the closed points don't change by being mod some higher power. So these, it's not all of these things. It's exactly the ones which are not très ramifié. So it's everything except for the extension, the twists of extensions of 1 by mod p cyclotomic, which are très ramifié, which don't come from finite black group schemes. So those are exactly the things which emit a finite flat model after restriction to k primed for some. I should have said that I'm now taking k primed to be, yeah, I probably should have told you what k primed was. I'm taking k primed to be sort of like k2 high to the 1 on p to the 2f minus 1, where this is like unramified extension, sort of the universe. The sort of biggest tame thing you need to capture all of the characters of the two-dimensional representations of the inertia. Okay, so all of the representations of this kind do become finite flat over this extension and conversely. Another way of characterizing these, which will be relevant in a couple of minutes, is this is exactly the rho primed, which have a non-Steinberg Serre weight. So if you like, we can restrict. If I just restrict, if you don't know anything about Serre weights, just restrict to k equals qp. And these mean all of the ones which come up to twist from some modular form of weight less than p plus 1. But if you do know about Serre weights, I mean all of the things which one of their Serre weights is not a twist of sim p minus 1 tends to sim p minus 1, and so on. OK, so right, I need one more piece of notation before I state the theorem. So what are these things? Another way of looking at these things is that these are exactly the things which are reductions mod p of potentially crystalline GK representations, say of Hodge type 0. So Hodge type 0 just means the same condition I mentioned up there of all the Hodge type weights being 0 and 1, which are crystalline. Over k primed. So they become crystalline over some tame extension. And associated to such a thing, if I have such a representation, I have a. So maybe I should give these representations a name, say rho. There's tau, which is the Wedelin representation of rho, restricted to inertia, and that's just this thing here is just a two-dimensional representation of the inertia group of k primed over k. So these things are simple. These are just sums of characters, just sum of two characters. And this notion of a crystalline representation of being this is called the inertial type of the representation. And as you would expect, you can read it off on the Italfi module world or the Kissin module world. So I can make versions of these various stacks where I don't just demand descent data, but I demand the descent data is kind of this tame type. So let me just pretend I've done that. So then I get things which I can call this. So it's the same thing as above, but instead of just having descent data, the descent data has some actual fixed inertial type. And the one other piece of notation I think I need is that given tau, I can get something called sigma of tau, which is a finite dimensional irreducible E representation of, well, in this setting, I think I just want a representation of GL2 of this residue field K, the residue field of capital K. And what is this? This is the what you get from the inertial local Langlands correspondence. Of any R. I should say, in this tame setting, this is something very explicit. So in the case that this is this representation is really a sum of characters, of sort of never one characters of this group, this is just a principal series representation of this GL2 of the residue field, and otherwise it's a cuspid representation of this. But they're just explicit delinistic representations of these rather nice groups. OK, so now, for the theorem, I'm going to just assume that tau is not trivial, although there is a version of the theorem. There should be a version of the theorem in the trivial case. It's just I would have to change some things, and I don't want to waste time on that. But I'm now ready to state the main result. OK. So I should say this is work in progress, though. I think it's only, maybe it's about 70% written, so I should say it's kind of an expected theorem, but I think everything should work out. And this is going to be the main theorem of this paper with Ana Caraiani, Matt Emerton, and Dave Savitt. So, expected theorem. So Caraiani begins with a C, not a K. So kegs for short. The names are up there. And I think I've got six parts. So first of all, I'm mostly going to talk about the special fibers, in fact, maybe almost entirely here. But all of these things here, what did I call the C less than or equal to 1A. And Z is less than or equal to 1A. Sorry, these should be 1s. So these are the special fibers. These are all reduced. OK, the closed points, I told you about the closed points of this one, but the closed points of this one have kind of the expected form. So closed points these correspond exactly to the rho bar. Well, I could say something about rho bar having crystal nibs, a particular type, but I want to talk about Serre weight. So the rho bar admitting a Serre weight which is in the Jordan Holder factors of the reduction of this representation mod P. So this representation was over E, but you can easily choose an OE lattice and reduce mod P and semi-simplify. You get some finite set of Jordan Holder factors, which are just representations of GL2K, which are Serre weights, and it's exactly the rho bars that have one of those as a Serre weight. Okay, the dimensions of all these things are the same. They are all equidimensional. Yep.
Sigma of R.
Yes.
Is
No, so I mean, I'm just fixing tau. I mean, the closed points of this, any particular closed point gives you a row bar. But I fixed tau already. I mean, I'm.
But this is the set of things which are the reductions of things that have tau.
Yes, that's also equivalent. The definition is it was a scheme theoretic image of a morphism of stacks with some properties and so on. So, yeah, I didn't just define it on closed points. I mean, not on closed points, these things are some weird define. You know, they're not, there's not some explicit set of what description of what the points of the scheme theoretic image are.
But it's the image of C tau.
Yes, and the C taus are some Kissing modules of type tau with some Kollwitz condition and so on. I'm stating this in this form for a reason that will hopefully become clear in a few minutes. So these are equidimensional of the expected dimension, which turns out to be the degree of K over QP. Maybe I'm not going to write this, but I should say that the C descent data is just the disjoint union of these ones with different types tau. So that helps orient. And then I can describe the irreducible components of the special fiber of the tau thing. This has 2 to the f components, irreducible components. And they're basically determined by the Dodonov module. So they're indexed by the equations. I'll just write f I equals 0 and vi equals 0. So what do I mean? So this was some moduli basically of finite flat group schemes with descent data. You can get a Giordano module from them, and the Giordano module breaks up under the embeddings of K into FP bar. So you sort of get an F and a V on each of them, and you just have equations for each. So these are indexed by the embeddings of K into FP bar. The irreducible components of the Galois thing are a little more complicated, but they have a. Let me actually tell you what they are on this. If I tell you what they are on this, you deduce what they are on this, because this is just a closed substack of this. So, in fact, given this is a closed substack of this almost by definition, and they're equidimensional, this is just a union of irreducible components in here. So, the irreducible components of this thing have a natural labeling by Serre weights, and in such a way that the rho bar is in the kind of sigma bar component, if and only if sigma bar is a Serre weight for rho bar. So, the same statement holds for these tau parts, except now that you have to have sigma bar as a Serre weight for rho bar and sigma bar as a Jordan Holder factor of this sigma of tau bar. And then, in fact, in that case, there's some earlier work of Broyan-Mazar, which look at, in maybe a more combinatorial way, these finite flat models and the Galois representations according to them. And from that perspective, they also have a way of labeling the Serre weights in sort of labeling there's a way of labeling the Jordan Holder factors of this, I guess it goes back to Fred Diamond, by sort of elements of this sort of, you can think of this as being the power set of the set of embeddings, and there's a natural labeling. Sort of generically, the Serre weights, you have exactly 2 to the F Serre weights, but sometimes there's sort of missing Serre weights. And what you see in those cases is that in the kind of missing case, the components here sort of collapse somewhat. They map to something of lower dimension. And the other cases, you kind of have a component mapping to a whole component. In fact, say something a little more general. So there is if I fix a particular tau, there exists an open dense substack Uh, such that if I restrict the morphism to U, then this is actually an isomorphism. And furthermore, the closed points, so the corresponding row bars, so the closed points of U, are reducible representations, and they only have a single Serre weight. But because this is dense and open, I mean, this is really like a substat for each of the Serre weights. There's one that we, this isn't one weight in common, there's kind of a bit for each weight. So sort of generically, this is very simple. Generically, you just have a single model. Okay, and I maybe want to just spend sort of 4 minutes just saying something very brief about what goes into the proof of this. List of ingredients. So this reducedness comes from work in progress of Ana Caraiani and Brandon Levin. And this is a generalization of some statement in the case of trivial descent data, and maybe not the stack, but the sort of formal scheme world of Kissin, and the idea is to relate these things to local models at Iwahori level for kind of restrictions of scalars of, in fact, they're going to work in the K prime over K with GLN. They're going to work with GLNs, but we just need the sort of GL2 case. In Kissin's case, where there was trivial descent data, you had sort of maximal compact hyperspecial level. Okay, so it comes from some statement from local models. The second point here, this basically comes from work, a theorem, earlier work of mine with Mark on the Broimazar and the Buzzard Diamond Jarvis conjectures. So it's the equivalence between, what, as Mark was saying, between having a crystalline lift of type tau and emitting Serre weights to these particular properties. The third thing, this takes a bit of work, but morally you can see why this should be true. It should be true because you can check it locally, so you can check on sort of formal completions. And so it's really a statement, as long as you emit yourself some way of going up to characteristic zero, it's really some statement about dimensions of Galois deformation rings. So the dimension of the corresponding crystalline Galois deformation rings, which was computed by Kissin. So that tells you what those are giving you the deformation rings for the Z, the Galois representation stack, and on the C, you get the same dimension by Tate's full faithfulness theorem. So you need that for the Kissin stack. That you have at least 2 to the F components is easy, basically because you have the map down to the Dieudonné module stack, and you can just see what that is. You can just write that down. And for less than or equal to 2 to the F, you use this thing down here. You use that you understand this thing generically. And I'll say more about 6 in 2 seconds. So I've just got to say epsilon about how we prove 5 and 6. Again, I'm just going to tell you what the ingredients are. Yes. Yes. I mean, apart from the Steinberg thing. Because I've already said that I don't see any things with Steinberg weights, so. Correct. Yes.
So
Yes. This is what I was saying. Then the Z thing has less components. The C thing still has all the components. But the image of that corresponding component is not a whole irreducible component. It lies strictly in some codimension. Right, so five. So this is some statement that we deduce. So from six, you can kind of see the way the proof goes. From six, you can actually see that there is a labeling of components in such a way that at a generic point, you just have a single weight, and it's this sigma bar. But it seems to be completely mysterious from that why it should be the case that at sort of non-generic representations, like the irreducible ones, why they should have the right labelings. So there we deduce this from work on the geometric version of the Bromazar conjecture. So this is work of Emerton and me and Mark Kissin, and also some things like work with Tong Liu and Dave Savitt to kind of relate different definitions of Serre weights. But basically the point is that the geometric Bromazar conjecture, which we know in this case, tells you this kind of a level of formal completions, and that turns out to be enough to get this. And six is really where we actually have to do a tiny bit of work rather than just start sort of formally deducing things from completions. And so this is via actually sort of computing some X of Kissin varieties, Kissin modules, which is basically some calculations of Diamond and Savitt. They did the corresponding calculations for Broy modules with descent data, and sort of some bounds on dimensions of Kissin varieties. For irreducible row bars. So kind of bounding the fibers, the dimension of a fiber over an irreducible point, showing it's not like a whole component or something. Right, but I should stop. Thanks.
In number two, when you speak of rows which admit a Serre weight,
yes.
Do you mean that they're actually modular of the Serre weight, or just that?
Well, they're local.
It's in W of row.
Yeah, it's a local representation, so it wouldn't make sense to say it was modular of that weight.
Okay.
But if there was a Hilbert modular form, which locally had that representation, there'd be modular of that weight, and we know various other characterizations in terms of, you know, all characterizations are now known to be the same, I think.
Mm-hmm. So could you somehow hope to prove Serre's conjecture for, say, for Hilbert modular forms by getting some global version of this and then proving that your z's are equal to something?
So that would be lovely, but I think, unfortunately, we don't expect there to be any kind of global version of this. So yeah, that kind of falls into the motivation. So, I mean, you can kind of... So what turns out, you can kind of think of this r as being sort of a thickening of the algebraic part at some kind of increasing degrees of nilpotence, and somehow the global deformation rings seem to exist only in this sort of formal direction. You can't really expect global things to naively be reducibly. But what we do kind of hope is that patch modules in the Taylor-Wiles sense should behave well over these spaces. So, for example, I think it's reasonable to hope that the p-adic local Langlands might well behave well over this. The original motivation was this paper of mine with Emerton and Savitt, where we proved some conjectures of Christoph's about lattices in potentially Barsotti-Tate representations by some rather kind of detailed study of patch modules. But the idea is that you can kind of see what the patch modules should be. Some of the conjectures are basically trivial in the case here where you only have one Serre weight. And if you can kind of see that the patch modules behave well over this whole space, you can basically see what's going to happen at the more complicated points by sort of some kind of continuation. So the idea, the hope is not that global things will exist over this, but patched global things will behave well over this. Yeah, but that's some way away at the moment.
So when you say dimensions of Galois deformation rings, you're assuming that the rings, these are actual rings, or they're versatile deformation rings?
I mean, these are just the framed deformation rings, if you like, the usual framed Galois deformation
rings. So when you say it's equidimensional, you mean it's the dimension of the ring modulo the
Minus the framing thing, yes. But I mean, this is equidirectional. I mean, that's how we compute the dimension, but it's really the dimension. It's not just a formal dimension. It's the dimension in the stack sense as well. I mean, it is an algebraic stack. There is a presentation, and you take the dimension at the top minus the fiber dimension. Mm-hmm. Right. Right. But the way we compute it is, yeah, it's that you frame, and then that gives you the dimension. Then you have to subtract off the sort of GL2 framing to get the actual dimension.
And the presentation in this case is something fairly explicit? Or?
No, I mean, I've got no idea. Yeah, I have no idea of a presentation of this thing. We prove that this thing is algebraic by verifying Artin's axioms. That's what we do. So that doesn't really give you some nice. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess it gives you in some sense some presentation, but you've used Artin approximation for your versal.
Right. No, but in this particular, I was wondering in this particular height one.
I mean, perhaps. Perhaps if you're over QP or something, maybe, I don't know. I haven't thought about it. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. Mine is not a question, but a statement. I mean, I missed the definition, really, of this sub E. Are these things defined by sort of some closure of the generic fiber? Or are they really representing something over Z mod P to the A?
I'm really representing things over Z mod P to the A, yeah. In the local models argument, there's buried some very unpleasant argument relating. So these things, if I define the same things with A's instead of 1's, and these things, like the special fiber of the one with an A here is not this, but it's some nilpotent thickening of this. So there's some rather unpleasant argument when you actually really want to go to characteristic zero and relate the things, and it's kind of all built in with this and so on. But these things really make sense just over mod P to the A. So the E here just meant I just look at O mod uniformizer to the A modules, algebras. And the type is something that, because everything is tame, I can think of the type as just being, it can think of it as being an E representation or a mod P representation. It's the same thing. There's no subtlety there. The tameness is important for that.
Other question, remarks? So we thank Toby again.